Good evening, viewers. Welcome to People and Stories. I'm your host, Jackie Nawibwamu. And tonight, I bring you an interesting guest who's an award-winning author, a poet, a life coach, and mentor. Richard Mwebesa, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Jackie, for having me. I'm so honored to be on set today.
Okay. So, Richard, let's dive right in.
There's something about firsts, but the second book I will say is a book that I wrote out of conviction. I remember I said I'm a Christian. So one time I'm praying, just praying how to promote my book. So I used to do quotes, quotable quotes. Yeah. These quotable quotes were, I was using them to promote my first book. Out of the crowd. So I'd get quotes, then I put them on flyers. Then I push out those quotes, yeah, to nudge people and give like a call to action. So I'd compile a number of flyers. So one time I'm praying, I get convicted that convert these quotes into a book. That's why I'm like, quotes don't sell. I mean, who even buys books of quotes? I've never come across, number one, on any book of quotes. I mean, how do you monetize even? Who buys quotes? So I was arguing.
Especially from a single author.
Yes, a first time author.
A book that's a collection of different people's quotes.
Yes.
But a single author.
Yes.
So many quotes.
Sure. So it was something very interesting because it was a conflict in my heart. I was like, I cannot, I'm going to waste time, yes, doing this book. But the conviction was very clear. As a Christian, I believe God was speaking to me very clearly. So I said, okay, anyhow, let me go ahead and do it. So I did it. Little did I know, this is actually the book of quotes that won the award, the Akaba Awards. Yes, it's the one and it's the same book that was quoted by Oprah. So true story, Oprah quoted one of the quotes in here. The quote that was quoted was hope has wings that make it fly. Yes, so I think her team were compiling different quotes world over, quotes about hope. Yes, because at one time in my life I was going through a rough patch. Eh? Yes, growing up, my elder brothers had fallen sick. They are very brilliant minds. Yes, I think one of them, by the age of six, knew all the presidents in the world, their capital cities, and all the countries in the world. Very interesting. So when he fell sick, and my elder brothers fell sick, there was a bit of tension at home. So when I was writing that quote, I remembered those times, because my mom passed on, but she also fell sick at one time, and I was nursing her. So she used to be a very positive person. She used to tell me, Richard, there's hope. Worry not, things will be better. They'll be better. So, yes, much better than that time, that episode. Yes, but that said, that time, when I was writing that quote, I remembered those moments. Yes, when I was nursing her in hospital, when she was very sick and very ill, and you're not seeing hope around you, and there's tension. So I wrote that quote at that time. But back, I think her team was looking for. Compile content for quotes about hope. So I think because my book is on Amazon, they came across it and they flipped through the book and maybe they saw something they liked, and that's how I got on the panel. So I was actually very excited.
Yeah.
I didn't know because every week I check online how my work is performing. Yeah, so I landed on it. Very interesting. The other quotes, I think she had about 4 quotes of her own. In there, she had about 10 quotes from different people world over. There were people like Michelle Obama, there were people like the late Desmond Tutu, Mariah Carey, and a number of other people I don't know. Yes, then mine popped up.
Of COVID, you know, locked behind our house doors, you just, the writing got to work.
Now, one other thing I didn't mention, how did I get nudged to write? Because I was very convicted. One thing I saw during COVID 2020, Because that's the time I wrote this book of quotes. I saw people pass on. So I remembered that experience reminded me those bad memories I had when I used to be in hospital. Yes, when I was in hospital. Because in my S4 vacation, I was actually my whole S4, I used to nurse my mom, come from home, then go to hospital and school. But there's a time that whole year I was in hospital nursing my mom. So the hospital became like second home. So I'd come from hospital, go to school, day school, then go back like that. So I didn't like the experience in hospitals, because when you're admitted for a long time in hospitals, there are many things you see. People pass on in the wards. There's always wails in the night. There are cries. Even the smell of the benzene, because so it wasn't good. Then you're sleeping on the floor. So that those moments were not so good in my life. But I believe those things had to happen to me so that they bring out the stories that now I'm telling to others to give them hope. Yeah, so when I saw people dying during COVID, there were sirens. If you remember that time, it was intense. I even lost some family members. It was a very tough time. So I was really convicted in my heart and said, God, no one knows me. Actually, I remember I was praying on my bed. I said, God, no one knows me, but this thing, only thing I know how to do is write. God, use me to write something that will inspire and bring back hope in the hearts of other people, because people had lost hope, especially those who were sick or had sick people, and many condolences to those that lost loved ones during that time. So that conviction is what now motivated me, even through prayer, to say, let me use my voice as a writer. And that's how the book came out. Little did I know that there are other stories coming up. Yes, through it.
Oprah quoted it. Did you see a spike in sales?
The answer is, in a way, yes. Yes. As I mentioned, all these build credibility for an author. It helps you as an author to put your work out there, to improve your work. So yes, and many more reviews came. I mean, I've had actually hundreds of reviews. God has been so good to me. So good to me. Who am I? A first-time author? And you win awards like that, and your work actually scales. If it's not good, then who is it? Nzani. It's God, for real.
Back to your O level, nursing your mother.
Yes.
You said you're sleeping on a hospital.
Yes, true. Great B Hospital, Entebbe.
Oh, yes. Yet here you are.
Yes.
So vibrant.
Yes.
And some people go through something so small and they become bitter for the rest of their lives. Where do you find your, what's your source of joy?
I think for me, my healing has always been in the words that my late mom used to tell me. Positivity. There's always a brighter day tomorrow. And if you look at the work in all my books, I'm a hope advocate. If you look at, there's a major, very strong theme in all my work, which is about hope. Of course, hope, the quotes, there's a segment for this, about hope, love, character, lifestyle, and hope. Then my poetry book, Thistle of the Now, is also a book of about poetry, about hope. If you see the key elements and themes in there, then this is inspiration. But also my seventh chapter, the last chapter, is called Defined by Perseverance, which talks about persevering hope. Keep going even when things look grim and gloom. So for me, I think those moments growing up always anchored me. But I think one of the key aspects also is my spirituality. I love God. Yes, as I said, I'm not ashamed to tell the world. Yes, that who is my rock? It is Jesus. You may see Richard here, but all the things I do is because I am standing on that rock. So, yes, so it's Isaac Newton who say that if at all I've seen far, it's because I've stood on the shoulders of giants. Yes, now for me, if at all I am who I am or what I am, it's because I've stood on Christ, who is the rock. He's been so encouraging to me. I always knew there was a brighter tomorrow. Yes, and the healing also received from salvation, reading the Bible, has helped me a lot. Yes.
Of these three, this was a free book, right?
Yes,
tell
the book of quotes.
About, I've never quite understood someone, I mean, the effort someone goes through to produce mm-hmm. something and then give it out for
free.
It's not like mangoes in a plantation, because you're sure the next season mm-hmm. or in a week mm-hmm. others will come. But to give out a book free, and yet you invested so much in it.
Yes.
How does that make financial sense? I'm sorry.
Now, as I told you, this book just didn't make sense to me. As planning a done work, because writing is not easy. You have to pay money, you have to pay an editor, you have to work with a designer, you have to typeset the work and the content and align your work. So you spend some money. So as I'm thinking of pricing the book, I always consult God first. I went back into prayer and asked God the price for the book. The conviction again was very clear. This book is not for sale, Sebo. That is a free book.
Okay.
You better give it away free. I was like, now, God. First of all, you're telling me to write quotes. How am I going to monetize these quotes? Number two, you're now telling me to give away the book free. How are these things going to work?
Like Jacob wrestling.
Anyhow, I said, okay, let me obey. Now, I didn't know the book will win an award. Will be quoted by Oprah. I mean, I didn't know. So I think for me, the lesson for me there was obedience.
True.
If you're going to do anything, be obedient to God. Be obedient in everything that you do. So I think for me, the highlight let it go. There's a scripture I love so much in the Bible. It's in Ecclesiastes. I think chapter number 11. Yes, that says, cast your bread upon the water, so for you do not know, where it will go. But in due time, it will return unto you. So for me, I looked at the book as a seed. Because when you cast a seed in good soil, and a book that is going to help people build them, eventually, the rewards will come from places you least expected. That's why I said the award came, international award, then me being appointed continental level Africa to be a judge, then now Oprah, who I don't know, who does not even know me, is doing her things, her team is doing their things, now they pick on the book. I mean, if it weren't God, then who would that be?
Okay. Is it still free?
Yes! The e-copy is free, but of course there's a cost to produce the book. Yeah, so it becomes expensive printing. So the book is still free, the e-copy. Whoever needs it can get it.
So you're still waiting for whatever you the returns of whatever you cast out there?
I'm still waiting. Maybe one day they'll come, bigger than I've seen so far. I don't know.
Thank you, Richard. Let's go for a short break. We'll be back. Stories. We're still here with our guest Richard Mwebesa. Now, looking back to where you came from, choosing what did you study at Makere
University?
Chamugo.
Yes. My first degree, I did a bachelor's in management science, but I majored in marketing, so I'm a marketer and salesman.
You market your books?
Yes, I do that myself. Then I went and did an MBA. Where I specialize in project management at Makerere University.
So which means writing comes naturally to you? You didn't even have to do any schooling?
No. It's natural. It's a God-given gift and talent. Yeah.
Do you suppose that in the future, the writing will overtake the insurance and let one go? Because they seem like two different fields altogether.
Honestly, no.
You want them both?
I believe, let me tell you something I discovered as a revelation. When God creates us, he puts in us elements, what I call elements, gifts. Now these gifts are in us. As we grow, it is upon us to discover who we are. And that subject is very interesting because I talk about it at length in chapter number one of my first book. My first chapter is called Defined by an Authentic Identity. And one of the biggest questions, three questions, which I call keys, which I wrote about at length in chapter one, is finding out who you are, why you're here on earth, which denotes your purpose, then lastly, your direction or where you are headed, which is denoted by your choices. So I believe, and I'll say this, I've never said it to anyone, I've only told my wife, I guess, about this, because she's my best friend. Okay. Yeah. So I've told her, the Richard you see here, being good and great or excellent or outstanding at what he does as a marketer, is because the other part of him has been discovered and explored and put to task, to work. The author. Now, for me, how did I know this? When I was in my A-level as an entertainment prefect.
Okay.
Yes, true story. I think for me, my A-level time was a time for me to discover myself. Nezula, as they say in Luganda, is for me to discover myself, all the key elements in me. So as the entertainment prefect. Now, naturally, the entertainment prefect was the chairman of the music, dance, and drama club. Now, one thing I've always known is I am an artist. Everything art makes sense to me. From childhood, from the time I was born, that's who I am. Everything art. When I was in primary four, I won a national art contest, fine art contest, for wildlife, as a painter. Yes, I was that good. But then when I grew up, I changed in my O level, I entered performing arts, music, acting. At one time, I also participated as an actor in The Last King of Scotland, as an extra. So I was very active in performing arts and music. So also one thing about writing was because I explored my music writing skills, because I was part of a group at the time.
You write music?
Yes, I still write music. We're actually Palm Award nominees way back in 2005, a number of awards in that group as a lead vocalist and writer. So all those things, art, made sense to me. Yes, they made sense to me. So I believe that if, when I was in my A-level, if I didn't do music, then I would fail in class. I was top of my class. True story, at NAS, in the arts class, every time, end of term, they would read the top 10, but the top 5 would go on the platform and get recognized as top of my class, entire A-level. And people would ask me, Richard, you never winter, you know winter, reading in the night. But how do you do it? So I'm like, guys, for me, actually, my class teacher said, but Richard, you're always in music. You're going to flunk. Class, I told him, watch the space. Watch the space. So I realized me doing my art is what makes things in class meaningful. So if I don't do the art part, then this other thing will be incomplete. It will suffer. So if I do this, then these other things make sense. Then if I don't do the work, then the art also doesn't make sense. Am I making sense? Hope I'm not confusing. So, yes, so I realized that all these now accentuate each other. They support each other. So when I'm doing the work, the insurance, marketing, then I don't do the art, then I feel incomplete. I get bored, I miss this part. Then for me, when I get to do this, then this makes sense. This side, and then this makes sense at the highest, this side. So once I realized that about me, then I'm like, man, this is who I am. Now, because of who I am, I ought to be the best at who I am here and everywhere else.
Interesting.
Yes.
Now, for someone who reads widely and has had, as a product of mentorship,
yes,
who are the influential people in your life?
I think my biggest teachers or coaches are my parents. Because these are people who see you from the day you're born. Yes, so they know your weaknesses, they know who you are. There's nothing new.
You're everything.
Yes, that they will not see. I think why I say so is because I respect my dad so much. He's a retired colonel, army man in the Air Force, called retired Colonel Sezi Mugasi. I think for me, he's my biggest anchor. Yeah, because he raised me. Being a soldier, naturally, you'll be raised in a strict way, because you have to build discipline in everything that you do. His mantra at home was always, no work, no food. No stories. Everyone at home had to carry their full weight. No excuses, no stories.
What do you mean, no work, no food?
That was his mantra. You don't work,
don't,
he gives you tasks. And he asks you in the morning, have you understood what I've said? These are your tasks, these are your cures today. You're going to sweep the house, you're going to mop. We had actually almost 3 maids, a house help at home. But my friend, you had to do your part, your work. He would let them supervise you, because he had to teach you to work and to enjoy work. So he gives you the chores, he asks you, have you understood? Yes or no? Yes. He repeats. If you've not understood, you say no. He repeats. Then in the evening, accountability, no stories. He calls you, huh? This is what we were meant to do. Did you deliver what you did? The moment you've missed, trouble. Big trouble. Yeah? You'd still have the supper, but the way you have the supper, you feel as though you've not had it. Yes, he would make you accountable to everything. Now, as a child, you'd think, this guy is just being hard. But later, when you grow up, you realize, this is the person who was disciplining me so that I become who I am. To love work, to love to do things, to also have the right morals, the right people, or love people. That heart that loves people. Then my mom, when she was still alive, of course, the encouragement. My biggest fan, she's the person who discovered I'm a musician. She's the one who discovered I'm also a writer and a poet. Yes, she would see those elements in me. Then she says, encourages me. Now parents encourage you to do all the things you do as you are. So I think they are the biggest influences. But then also my pastors. Yes, my pastor, Bibiana Wangari, been encouraging through praying with me and giving me the hope and encouragement to keep going. Yes, from the spiritual perspective. Then my coaches. Yes, she's Kenyan.
What? Yes. And then pastors didn't work for
you. No, they are there. But you see, God brings the people that ought to be. Pepe is Congolese.
Oh, yeah.
But how did he bring him to me? Yes, I mean, it's not about who they are. I mean, their nationality or what. We're all one person. So God will bring anyone.
I'm being a patriot.
But there are many other Ugandan people who are my friends, who I also look up to. Of course, I respect my boss a lot. Yes, Alan Mafari is a very intelligent person. And if he's watching, big up to him. Like for real, yes, he's a coach as well. The way he leads by coaching. Yes, he's a very profound person. I've always told him he's an author. I don't know if he's seeing, he should also write one day. Alan, I've always said you should write. Maybe he will, maybe he won't.
Now, since you speak so highly of your father.
Yes.
Are there any of his, you know, his way of doing things? Are there any ways you have kept intact that you're sharing with your children? The strictness,
I think I'm not very strict because I'm not a soldier. But I've also had that exposure of going to my A-level. It's an army-founded school. Not military, but army-founded, yes? So it's main curriculum, but army-founded. So those principles and elements of discipline, hard work, execution, were always things that I picked on. Now, for my children, I'm a very loving dad. I'm not very strict on them, yes, like he was on me. But I think 3 lessons I would pick. One is persistence. Yes, soldiers are very, very persistent people. That aspect of resilience and perseverance, yes, is quite critical. I always try to teach my children that. Then 2, he was a very stickler to good morals and good judgment and behavior. Ha! He's a person who would never tolerate bad manners. Never at any time. Straight and pointed. He was always a very straight and pointed man, and still is, by the way. So I think that is something that I also picked on. Then the last thing is, he was a very loving man. We would always wonder, all his siblings would come at home. He raised them, literally. There are other strangers who would come at home. He would pay fees for them. And we're like, man, How does this work? Strangers, I mean, when he goes on a trip, you are sure he's going to carry a stranger home, a child. Then he would pay fees for them without anything. He would feed them, clothe them, love them, just like any other person. So I respect my dad. He's my hero. Okay. He's my hero.
Now, back to writing.
Yes.
If someone came to you and said, Richard, I want to be a writer.
Yes.
But, and like, okay, mm-hmm. the different, I'm going to give you two different kinds of people. Mm-hmm. One is not naturally a writer, mm-hmm. yeah, does not have the gift of writing, mm-hmm. but they have such a story that they feel if they don't let it out, mm-hmm. they will implode.
Okay.
So they come to you raw as mm-hmm. they are. Mm-hmm. And then another mm-hmm. is of a writer. Mm-hmm. They want to write, they've been writing, mm-hmm. but for some reason they haven't produced a book. Because mm-hmm. they're kind of scattered. Mm-hmm. What would you advise each?
You've explained to different people.
Yes.
One thing I subscribe to, thought that any human being can become an author.
Yes. I believe it.
Now, when people see authorship and they see writing, they confuse the two. There's a difference. Now, remember I said author becomes authority about a subject matter.
Yes.
As much as they write, because they are authors who also produce content. Yes, they become authors. Yeah? They not necessarily write, but can produce content, either which can be shot or curated. And kept and preserved, either in film, or could be preserved in terms of script, or it could be curated into audio as well. So authors are people who are content creators. Now I'm speaking from my creative side as a marketer,
okay.
on the other side. Eh? But what is important, I believe anyone can write. Why? Because you don't need to become an author, you don't need to be a writer.
True.
Why? Because there are writers who can, professional writers who can put together your story into the story writing mechanics and techniques and then release it. They guide you, they are editors, yes, they are content writers, yes, they are also what we call creative writers, they are also copywriters. All these are people who can pick your story for you and help it transform it into an award-winning or golden goodread. Now, me being a coach, and now also an author and also a writer, because I write my own work. I don't use other people to write. No. I write my own work. Brings me to the second part, that not every writer out there may be good to put content down together into the story writing techniques. Now, also being a poet, because poetry is hard, I will tell you. I'm a poet as well. It is hard. It's the hardest form of writing, because it's the devices, poetic devices you use are so deep. There's a lot of diverse and depth, yeah, in there. Now, also being a poet, that makes me now a good author and writer, because there are different techniques we can use to evoke the content or emotions in the stories, so that when we present them, these stories are page turners, what we call page turners. When someone picks your story,
they don't stop,
they keep flipping. Now, I don't want to bore you with the mechanics. There's a lot in there. There are about over 70 poetry devices that writers or literary people use. I can maybe tell you about five, yeah, common ones. Of course, there's what they call dissonance, then there's metaphor, there's similes, there's elegy, there's epic. So there are different, idioms, there's verse and meter. Those are just a few, there are over 70. Now, when as a coach, because I'm also a coach of writers, I've already coached about 7 people. I think 4 are published. They've already authored their work. Others are still on the way. So for me, what I look at is in the story the person has.
That
Thank
has been
you.
Our guest tonight, Richard Morosa, a prolific writer, nascent though, with 3 books to his name, an award winner, a mentor, a coach, and
a poet.
A poet.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Good night.